everybody. Welcome to Tennessee WildCast, the agency, Tennessee Wildlife Resources Agency's podcast. Here for you, trying to get the information out, keeping y'all up to date on what the agency's doing and what's going on in wildlife. I've got Mr. Barry Cross with me today as the co-host. Doug's on a secret mission, I guess we could say, maybe not. I think he's chasing some fish today.
He might be. And we got Parker Swan and Bill Swan with us.
Yes.
Talk a little trapping today.
It's going to be a good show.
Yeah, it's going to be a great show.
So I'm glad to have Barry in here helping us out and glad to have the Swans with us. So anyway, let's talk about regulations a little bit. Fishing season is around the corner. It's here for some people.
It's here. I've seen a lot of good fish being caught already. I've had some pictures sent from some of our agency lakes, and I've seen some good catches brought in on some tournaments out at Kentucky Lake. So fishing's picking up, and people are starting to think about it more and more. You know, we had a little bit of a cold snap, but it hasn't hampered anybody that's got the bug to go fishing. So
yeah, there was a picture on our Facebook not too long ago of a guy caught a sturgeon down below Cordell Hull in the snow.
So that's right. Neat. You know, and you know, you're starting to see a lot more sturgeon being caught. And if you don't know, if you ever do catch one, if you can get a measurement of it, then possibly weigh it and send that information in to us. Please release the fish, because these fish, it takes them about 10 to 15 years to reach maturity to breed in the wild.
Right.
And there's been a good effort being made to restore these fish to a sport fish in the state, and I think we're making headway.
And there is a law against keeping them, so that's not a suggestion. That is
right.
A rule. So put them back and enjoy catching them, but make sure you put them back.
Right.
And
you can look that up in the fishing guide, which is out.
Is
now.
Out, and we want to show
be in stores near you.
Yeah. Show some of the changes for the 2017 season, just to highlight these, and then you can find more information in your guide. But it's out there in the stores. It's online under Four Anglers on our website, and that's tnwildlife.org. And you can get all the information you need there. But anyway, few changes. Crappie limits are down on Kentucky Lake to 20 per day.
Still got to be 10 inches.
You know, special licenses for native Tennesseans. And so anyway, guide licenses, things like that you need to pay attention to.
There's not any real big changes. It's
no.
Just something you need to be aware of if you're going out. And always, you know, take a look at the area that you're going to make sure that you know what the limits are and the size and everything.
So may not be the same as last year.
That's right.
So anyway, well, let's get to our guests and talk a little bit about trapping. We've had a lot going on around the state with trapping. There's been some outreach events and more to come. And trapping is... maybe you could say it's heating up again, or it's coming back. You know, it's not as popular as deer hunting or fishing or turkey hunting or something like that, but it's something people can get involved in and enjoy, and it's
right. You know,
another chance to get outside.
We've had a couple of different trapper training days here in the state, and Bill, you were telling me that you're involved in one of those, right?
Or well, I do a trapper education instructor for the agency, volunteer instructor. You know, I want to hit on something you said, though, about trapping coming back, and we talk about this in the classes. When you're driving around the road in November, December, you see orange vests, four-wheelers on a trailer, you know, and you say, oh, those guys are deer hunting.
Mm-hmm.
But... and you see somebody pulling a bass boat, that guy's going fishing, or a John boat or John boat camo, that guy's going duck hunting.
Yeah.
But when you see just a pickup truck driving down the road and somebody with a, you know, just a jacket on and a regular hat and maybe a few buckets in the back of their truck, you might think they're going working. You never know, they might be a trapper. So you don't.
That's true.
It's not, they're out there. You just, they're just not as noticeable. There's a lot more people that trap than you would think. It's a, you just don't. They're just not as obvious.
Right.
Now, small game. You know, small game hunters have kind of waned off over the years, but they're still out there. Has trapping seen the same loss or is it still gaining popularity?
That's a tough question to answer. I haven't kept up with, you know, the numbers of people that trap, but I know when I go to the trapping conventions, the Tennessee Fur Harvesters has a great one at Fall Creek Falls every year. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of people show up there.
Yeah.
When I do the trapping classes, you know, the trapper education classes, I have a good turnout.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you talk to people that are out there, you know, about trapping, they're always interested and want to learn more. You know, I can sit here and probably think of three or four people just this year that, you know, I've taken them or talked to them about it, and they've gotten interested, and now they just take off with it.
Right.
It's just another good reason to be outside.
Yeah.
You know, you've got to, you know, I heard one fellow say, you know, well, you go sit in a deer stand, you know, in a blind, just sit there long enough, you'll get one, you know. But now when you get out here in the outdoors and you're going to go one-on-one with some coyotes or maybe you're trying to catch foxes or depending on what you're after, you know, it's a, I don't want to use the word cat and mouse, but, you know, it's a game of wits.
I mean, I was thinking. There's kind of a science to
being able to trap. Yeah, absolutely. You got to know the animal. And like we were talking before the show here, even if you're after flying squirrels in your attic, you know, you still got to know, you know, you got to know that how to catch them. I mean, that's and that's a great thing that the agency offers is this trapper education class. We hit on that.
That's what I want to hit on first. I mean, what all is involved in trapper ed?
Okay, trapper ed is, I call it the hitting the high spots of trapping. We'll give you the basic, no different than hunter. We'll give everybody the basic general information to go to the woods safely. We're going to give you the basic information to go trapping and automatically, or not automatically, but we're going to give you that information. It's going to make you have your odds of success are going to be so much greater after coming to a class. Cause there's so many things we talk about that, like before the show, I told you that, you know, when I started trapping, I had no clue there was any kind of preparation work to your traps. I had no clue there was a certain way you did stuff for different animals. I had no clue there was, you know, so you just go out there and learn by trial and error. But by having the trapper education course available, a guy that maybe has trapped a little in the past, or maybe he's a veteran trapper, or maybe he's never trapped a day in his life, he can come to these classes. Doesn't matter, you know, he or she or how old you are, you can still come to these classes and you'll walk away with a basic knowledge that will make you increase your odds of success.
Right.
Dramatically.
And by the way, these classes can be found on tmwildlife.org. Find out how to sign up and where they're located throughout the state.
Yeah, there's actually a new page now dedicated to it. There was a little confusion between the Trapper Ed and Hunter Ed classes, which you were signing up for, but now I think it's been separated. So,
right.
But yeah, I would definitely recommend, you know, if a person's interested in getting into trapping, definitely looking for one of those classes, and hopefully there'll be some more of them in the future.
Kind of reduce that learning curve, I guess.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, it's I always refer back to my experience because it definitely was a trial and error learning curve. I didn't even know you were supposed to wear gloves. You know, I mean, so if I just touch that trap, I've immediately ruined any chance I had of catching a coyote or even a fox. Now, whereas with a raccoon, though, if I touch that trap, they're going to associate that with food if they've ever been around. So I might increase my chances, you know. So just things like that, you know, and even setting the trap up, everybody thinks you need, or I'd say everyone, but some people might think you need a real hair trigger on a trap, but really you don't. You know, you might want to make that pan pressure, what fires the trap, heavier. And you can actually be selective now. So, unlike I didn't know, I was catching skunks. So I can up my pan pressure. When a skunk steps on it, it wouldn't fire the trap. So I've just become selective with my trapping. So I've ruled out, not that you wouldn't ever catch one, but, you know, I've reduced the chances, unless that's what I'm after.
Lots of little nuances. I didn't know what the difference in traps are. I mean, I thought the steel jaw was illegal until I talked to you, but you can use steel jaw, and there are other types of traps.
Yeah, there's Okay, so in Tennessee, the law, I think it categorizes traps into three categories. And we're not talking about cage traps, though, but mm-hmm. you have steel jaw trap, a rubber jaw or soft catch trap, and then you have snares. Mm-hmm. So a steel jaw trap would be, they would both look almost identical, except the rubber jaw would have a, or the soft catch trap would have a rubber laminate inside the jaws where it actually catches holds the animal's foot.
Is that what we're seeing right here?
Yes, that's a rubber jaw. That's correct. That you can see there's some screws there holding that. That's a replaceable material too. So it, and when it wears out, you can replace it. That's a fox, I believe. Now the steel jaw trap, it basically looks the same, but it has to be used in a water application, stream, creek, tributary, pond, man-made reservoir. Mm-hmm. Like we were talking about earlier, the best way to decide is you can't put it in a mud hole in a logging road.
Yeah,
you know, that's not considered an impoundment. Mm. But yes, or steel jaw can be used on dry ground, but it has to be 12 inches in a burrow,
okay,
inside a hole or 12 inches back.
So there's a lot of things that you're going to learn in Trapper Ed, specifics
right.
like that. You know, the rules and regs and some techniques and
absolutely. I tell everybody, you know, we could sit here and we could do a 6-hour radio or WildCast on just trap preparation or tuning traps. I mean, you know, there's so many little tricks and things you can do to just to adjust your traps. So a lot of the traps, some of the more expensive stuff, right out of the box comes pretty much, set at 3 pounds of pan pressure and pan's already adjusted. And we talk about that. You know, if a guy wants to spend a little extra and cut down on some of that preparation work. Yes, and then bedding the trap, so if you're walking to your deer stand before daylight and you step on something that moves under your foot, I mean, you don't put all your weight on it and try to, you move. And so if an animal walks up to your trap set and he steps on the outer jaw, and the whole ground rocks under his feet, he's going to try to figure out what that was now, and he's not going to step there.
Right.
Mm. So we talk about bedding the trap, make a good solid trap bed.
Solid to put base.
It in. Yes, so the trap doesn't move, except when he steps on the pan, it fires.
So, and, Trapper Ed, I guess, is a good way to do that, but then there's all these different events.
That's
that,
right.
That I know you've been a part of here recently. That you've helped out was at the Buffalo Ridge. Is that
no? I didn't get. I
didn't, oh, you make didn't it get
up,
to go. To
I
that.
Was out of town for that weekend. Yeah.
Okay. Now, but that's that's a good example.
Absolutely, that's the Tennessee Fur Harvest and the agency did that in together. Absolutely, there's one coming up. I think this weekend at Hiawassee.
Okay.
I believe that's next Friday.
Depending
7th.
On when this show airs, it may have already passed, but. That May, there, okay. there are events out there
absolutely
for these for folks to learn
yeah,
more.
Yeah, you just need to go to the Tennessee Fur Harvester website. It's a good place to, and the agency website, I'm sure, would mm-hmm. Have that information there.
So what kind of more in-depth additional information do you think these folks will get at these different events like that? I mean, compared to the Hunter Ed, Trapper
Ed. They're going to they'll talk about preparing the traps. You know, when you buy traps brand new, they have an oil coating since it's metal. I mean, all metal, brand new metal has oil on it to keep it from rusting. So they'll talk about how to do trap prep because the oil has an odor to it, and how to descent or unscent your traps, whatever. You're going to talk about different types of baits and lures. You're going to talk about how to target certain animals. I mean, if you want to be water trapping versus coyote and canine trapping, you're going to learn how to catch bobcats, foxes, raccoons, mink, otter, all the different fur bearers out there. You'll go through.
You learn to identify a lot of different animals too, don't you?
Oh, absolutely. Identify that and by their tracks. I always tell, people will find a canine track, and there's always a couple of obvious things you look for. We talk about how to, to tell the two different, just at a glance, how to tell a canine from a bobcat. The bobcat has retractable claws, so there obviously wouldn't be any claw marks in there. And knowing, the looking for sign and, another thing that they'll learn is location. If you don't have good sign, don't set a trap there. And if you do have good sign, where would you set the trap? You know, right. If you're at a two or three roads are intersecting there, that's a great place because those animals will run those roads no different than you and I would. So, you know, road intersections, I mean, this, all those, like I said, you could go on for, you could, you know, you could spend a whole day just talking about locations, you know, but there's so many little things you'll, you know, you'll get that will definitely help you.
And trapping, the nose is what gets them, right? I mean, you put out a scent that brings them to
I always say, if we're after a coyote and he walks out into your food plot at your hunting club and that food plot's 4 acres and I've got a trap that's, you know, 6 inches in diameter, the jaw spread is laying there in the center of that field. Now, how do I get him there? That's one thing. What if the wind's not blowing towards him, though? So when you walk into a field, if there was a, you know, one tuft of grass that was taller than the rest, your eyes will naturally focus on that one thing. Mm-hmm. So a guy could put a, you know, a shed antler out there or a bone or a wing. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe you've been duck hunting, you got some wing feathers or something, you could put a few wing feathers. So now I've given the coyote, I've got him focused, you know, from 100 feet away. So now I've taken 3 acres and turned it into maybe a 10-foot radius. So I've got him to that point. And then once I've got him there, maybe I've scattered some feathers around on the ground. Now I've got his curiosity up. And then maybe even I've put a dirt hole set in there. If you got a, and so I've now he's looking around the, there you go. Now he's around those feathers. He's found this burrow that maybe has a, you know, a mouse or something down in there. So I've just taken a coyote that was in a 3-acre field, and I've got him into a 2 to 3 feet of where my trap is now.
Is there a trap in that picture right there?
There is. It's actually in the bottom right-hand corner of that picture.
Well, you can't see it, though.
You can't see it.
So that...
It's down in here.
So you basically set the trap. You've got a firm bed, and then you cover it with dirt.
Sifted dirt, and you want to put some kind of a pan cover over the pan or under the pan. Mm-hmm. Because we don't want to get any, I wouldn't want a hickory nut to get up under the pan. Then when he stepped on it, it wouldn't fire the trap. Mm-hmm. So you want to keep the under the pan clear of debris. You can do that with a pan cover. You can do that with a filler that can be put under the pan.
Mm-hmm.
That's one way of, you know, keeping that free of obstruction. Then we sift the dirt over the trap so we don't put any rocks or anything that can. I had a situation where, you know, I don't really know what it was. Well, something was digging the dirt hole and dug a rock out or flung a stick back up on my trap and then stepped in the trap, and the trap fired and the stick kept the jaws from shutting all the way.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's another reason to sift the dirt, you know. Mm-hmm. And you don't ever want to get sit on your trap. You want to lure the animal beyond the trap.
Right.
You want them to step in it looking at something beyond it, not, you know, the trap itself. I heard
that's
one
where the gloves come in.
That's right. Yeah. You don't want to touch the trap. I have two sets of gloves. One, I call them the scent-free gloves and the scented gloves. One set of gloves for handling the equipment. One set of gloves for handling the lure and bait.
And that leather, I guess, or whatever type of glove you're using, does it affect the trap and how the?
Yes, I mean, you don't want to. A leather has an odor, so I use matter of fact, there's a company called Big Game Gut Glove. They sell these big orange,
right?
Mm-hmm. You know, or I guess they're different colors, blue and yellow. They come up pretty high. I wear those just to, you know, to keep my scent off the traps, keep my clothes fairly clean if it's muddy. And then, like I say, I got the disposable surgical style gloves. I just carry them, and they're inexpensive, and you can buy a box of 100 and, you know, just handle your lure, and then, you know, you take one off and do the same time and then throw it all away.
Yeah.
Don't get it on you.
Unless you got something else, Barry, let's show some of the pictures you sent us, and we'll talk about some of the stuff that's going on in those shots. Here's a bobcat. What kind of trap is that?
That is either a I can't tell. It's either a Sleepy Creek number 3 soft catch or an MB550 two coil trap. But I use like we were talking about earlier in the show, I tend to, you know, you can buy inexpensive trap for $12 or $13 a piece, or you can spend $18, $20 a piece and get a, you know, a little bit better quality trap. I won't get into all the big differences in the two, but a little bit better made, mm-hmm. center swivel, got more swivel, better chain, more adjustable features, and that's number three, Sleepy Creek.
Mm-hmm. There's another bobcat.
Yep.
There's a raccoon.
Yeah, now that's a that trap there, you can't hardly tell it's there, but if you look down at the base of that tree on the right hand of the screen, that's what they call a dog-proof trap or a coon cuff trap style trap. I really recommend that if a guy's wanting to get into trapping. Raccoons are relatively easy to catch. And that trap is good around houses where you can get a house cat in it. But we do want to remember, though, that traps only hold the animal. They don't do any I got a laugh out of Barry on the house cat. We must be the story behind that. But they are any animal. I don't carry any inhumane products. There are, you know, their leg hold traps just hold them. This coon cuff just holds the raccoon. If you want to turn that animal loose, you can. Mm-hmm. One thing a trapper needs to have is a good catch pole mm-hmm. for handling the animal. The way to handle them, there's not an animal out there I can catch that I can't turn loose if needed.
Mm-hmm.
There's a coyote.
Important to have that tool with this guy.
Now, coyotes are a little tough to handle with a catch pole, but you can.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, you can. You know, they're just a stronger.
Yeah.
You just have to be a little more. You're dealing with a 30 or 40 pound coyote there versus a 4 to 5 pound raccoon, pound raccoon. Coyote can exert a little more force, but when you've got him with the catch pole, you're in control.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you can turn him loose. Or the red fox.
It's pretty. Your buddy that better watch out because it will swing on you.
Swinging him around.
Yeah, they call that the catch circle. Don't get in the catch circle.
Yeah.
that's a MB550 two coil trap there. I used some of those this year. I'm really impressed with that trap. It's, for the money, $18 a piece, and really good. That's red fox.
Yeah. The soft jaw.
That's what right there.
Can you release that animal, or is he damaged?
No.
The soft jaw keeps him.
No, there's the soft catch and the steel jaw traps. They just hold the animal. They just grab it and hold.
Mm-hmm.
The chains on them have swivels,
mm-hmm.
and so that keeps the animal from twisting and binding, hurt himself. He's only got about 10 or 12 inches to work with when that trap is secure, unless you've got it on a long cable or something. But most of the time, if you got it on a long cable. They'll go up and wrap around a tree, and they'll just be sitting there. I've actually walked up on a few that were, sound asleep, coiled mm-hmm. up. Mm-hmm. They're sleeping. And
they give up, just take a nap.
It just holds them there until you get there.
Yeah. Let's see. I mean, what is this right here, what we're looking at?
This was an otter-style set. That hole, I shoveled that out, cut that into the bank, and... made the water about 8 inches deep where it normally would have been about an inch or two. I made mm-hmm. it about 8 inches, 8 to 10 inches deep right there, and made that hole back in there. So when the animal's swimming around, otter or muskrat or beaver, they're real curious, and they're you got to remember, they're swimming around with their eyes at water level.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And he sees that. That's going to be a visual, just like the bone out in the middle of the food plot. This hole in the bank is going to be a visual attractant. Even if there's no scent in there, he's going to be curious and come over and see that. So. Mm-hmm. That's what that is. And then down in the water would be a leg hold trap with a drowning rig. He'd step in, get caught, and he'd swim to the bottom of the lake. I think we got a picture of a...
Yeah, and I think it's right after this one. Here's an example of a beaver, right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. Now, a beaver, if you'll notice, that trap's way up above his foot there. Got him good high leg catch. That's what you're after. And you achieve that through a heavy pan pressure, 4, 5, 6 pounds for beaver. He puts all of his weight on it, commits to it, steps down, and it catches him high.
And then there's the rebar in the picture. That's
right.
So
and
then,
if you look right there, go.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. Go I was right going to show you something we didn't even say. On that swivel right there is a trap tag. All traps have to be tagged with the owner's name or TWRA ID.
Okay.
That's
good information.
Important. Even snares and cage traps.
Okay.
But yes, the rebar, absolutely. The rebar has a slide on it. If you look in the top left corner there, you see that's about a 35-pound beaver down there at the bottom of the lake. Beaver, and if you look in the bottom right-hand corner to the right of the rebar, you'll see that dugout. You can actually see my dirt where I dug it out further down in there, but that's a shelf I've created in about 10 inches of water that'll allow the beaver to step, to climb out, and he steps in the trap. And the first thing a beaver does when he's caught or in danger is he dives to the bottom of the lake, mm-hmm. get out of sight, and he'll swim down to the bottom of the rebar. Then he gets caught down there, and he'll just basically dispatch himself.
Right. That's pretty cool. That's interesting. And then here's a real quick, just an example of what a class might look like if you're going to one of those classes. And you said this was held where?
That was Signal Mountain, just outside of Chattanooga. There was about 20 people there in that class. That was a good class, and it's always fun to, when we go to the classes there, there'll always be four or five that come out of there, and they're just gung-ho, got to go start trapping.
90 miles an hour.
That's right. Yeah, still going. Yeah.
You mentioned that Sean Edgman right there.
That's right.
A lot of our officers know a lot about trapping, don't they?
That's right.
You know, I've been out on some of these youth events. I think I went on toys one time, and mm-hmm. Randy Husky was doing some trapper training with those kids. That's where I first saw it, and it's really, really interesting, the fact that you can pick which leg you want to catch, you know, or
absolutely.
I mean, just the thought that goes into setting a trap around whatever it is that you're using to attract them.
That's exactly right. Be selective.
So I'm my hat's off to you, man. If you're out there doing it, maybe I get to come with you sometime.
Absolutely. I always tell people, if they want to go with me, just know that you got to check your traps every 36 hours. I go every day. Yeah. So know that every day during trapping season, if I've got traps out, I'm going to be out checking them. So if you want to go, call me the night before.
I'll call you. I'll come carry some stuff. I mean.
Well, we got about three more minutes before time's up here, but I know there's a couple things I wanted to hit.
Okay.
Nuisance animals, wildlife extraction, and then tanning. And that's those two things. Let's real quick hit on some of that.
Okay. Nuisance wildlife, I do that, animal removal. If you're wanting to get into trapping, I'd recommend the recreational trapping because you get less of the fun stuff. You're more, like we talked about, rats and flying squirrels and, you know.
But the techniques you learn in trapping are great for
absolutely
taking care of nuisance.
Absolutely. It doesn't matter if you're after rats or you're after bobcats. Mm-hmm. They all have you have to know how to catch them. That's exactly right. Tanning, there's really, you do it yourself or you can send it off and have it professionally done.
Mm-hmm.
I recommend everybody should try tanning something themselves just for the, here again, it's just another way to enjoy the outdoors and the wildlife. It's a little bit of, it's time consuming. And if you do it yourself, you got to skin the animal, you got to flesh the animal and go through the procedures. There's products out there. You can buy it, you know, any of your Cabela's, Sportsman's Warehouse, Bass Pros.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can send it off and have them tan. Now, if you're going to send them off, they need to be fleshed and dried, or you're going to have to FedEx it frozen. The flesh, and that's another thing you'll learn at these, the TFA agency trapping mm-hmm. courses, mm-hmm. and even through trapper education, learn how to skin and flesh and dry. A dried fur to me is, I call it beef jerky. It's semi-preserved. It won't last forever, and it doesn't have to be in the refrigerator. So,
that's a lot of information, a lot of cool stuff, and there's still more to talk about, I'm sure.
Oh, gosh, yeah, like I said, you're going forever about it.
Well, let's show this shot, because you can make earmuffs, right?
That's right.
That's an option.
You can customize anything you want when you trap it. That's right.
That's our dog, Cricket. She wasn't too crazy about wearing the earmuffs.
But your wife liked them, right?
Absolutely.
And you got a bobcat hat, right?
I got a bobcat. I've got it on in one of them.
Yeah, we showed that.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
So anyway, well, hey, I tell you what, folks, it's been a great episode. Thanks for joining us for this edition of Tennessee WildCast. You can find us anywhere. Good place to start is tnwildlife.org. You can listen, watch, and stay with us all the time. We're out there all the time, and all the old shows are out there. So keep coming back and keep watching. Thanks for coming.